So I guess we're gonna start. So welcome to this panel about fabric painting and dyeing. We're gonna talk about painting and dyeing fabric. What's the difference between painting and dyeing? Because you might need to know that. Paint lives on top of the fabric while dye chemically bonds with the fabric.
Fun facts.
So painting basics. Some paint is designed for fabric and some isn't.
That's true.
Yeah. Thanks, Beauty. Paint designed for fabric is specifically made to be flexible and move with the fabric. So if you use paints not made for fabric, you might notice that your fabric's gonna get really crusty, it's gonna change the hand of the fabric, it might be really stiff, and you don't want that. Maybe you do, and if you do, then you can use other things, but usually that's not something you're going for.
Right, usually with paint that is designed for fabric, it's either gonna come off or just totally jank up your fabric.
Or over time it'll crack, it'll dry.
Immediately.
Also, when you are buying fabric paint, do be careful what type you're buying. Very popular in craft stores are the 3D texture paints that make like those old puff paint shirts. And if you try to paint an insignia and it's in a textured puffy paint and it dries, it's gonna show all your brush strokes, it's gonna look a mess.
Yeah, if you want a puffy paint look, if that's what you're going
for.
Nobody
wants a puffy paint look outside of third grade.
I have used it. They make it in matte now. It's pretty good. But it's for like tracing certain things. But don't use a brush with it. Don't try to paint with it like you would another paint, because you're gonna get streaky strokes. It's gonna be glossy and messy and gross and just look like you don't know what you're doing. You want to look for paint specifically marketed for fabric, and if you go to a craft store, there will usually be a section for fabric dyes and fabric paints, and they'll say they're for paint. You can also buy fabric spray paints, which are pretty awesome if you need to cover a very large area. You can get it in an aerosol can now, or like an air pump type of can, bottle.
Also, if you have a fabric paint, it will usually bond with fake leather and even real leather. You should definitely try it on a small area, but most fabric paints are going to be acrylic-based, so they're plastic-based, and they're designed to bond to themselves. Otherwise, you'd have every layer of that paint peel off the next layer and just come apart like a weird peel of pastry. So they're designed to bond to other plastics. Most of the time, you can get a painted leather look, or just go straight to like candy leather, because we live in Texas and we have resources, and you can just buy paints that are intended for leather work.
So if you have a lot of acrylic paints sitting around already, just like the generic little bottles of craft paint, you can purchase something called a textile medium, and that's like a clear, kind of goofy-ish liquid that you mix in with your acrylic, and then it turns it into a fabric paint. So that's handy to have.
Just mind when you do buy normal acrylic, a lot of it is not highly pigmented, especially if you're finding something that's kind of just cheapy in the craft store aisle. So if you are going to mix in textile medium, go ahead and step it up and get a nice acrylic paint. Don't be tempted by those wonderful $2 bottles.
Right, I have used like the quality Liquitex like artist paint for actual painting. I've mixed textile medium in that, and that's been okay. It gets a little bit hard, like it's not as soft, it won't maintain the hand of your fabric, but for what I was doing, that wasn't important, so over time. Most quality paint needs to be heat set in order to be permanent and wash safe. And usually you'll do this by ironing. Sometimes it'll say you can throw it in your dryer on a certain heat setting. So just most fabric paints will give you directions on how how to heat set your project.
And if it doesn't say to do it, go ahead and get like a scrap of muslin and use it as a press cloth. So you just put it over whatever it is you are pressing, and you put your iron on top of that, and that will keep you from getting paint potentially all over your iron, over your ironing board, etc. What's up?
When using, you mentioned a spray on
paint. Mm-hmm.
Is that if I needed to
we are going
to
get there, I promise.
Ooh, girl.
We will get there.
I will warn about spray paint style dyes is that paint comes out really sloppy. It's not beautiful like when you get a can of spray paint for spray painting furniture where you can get a gradient. If you have that in your hopes and dreams, it's not going to get you there. You're going to have to do other methods of gradients.
Which will come with. With any painting, dyeing, any of this mess, always test on some extra fabric, the fabric you're using to make your garment, save some scraps, and test before you go and paint. Because you don't always know what the reaction is going to be. You want to make sure it's what you want before you throw that paint down there and then realize ultimately it was not good.
I have to dangerously destroy a lot of garments.
So if you need to mix paint, you can follow a color wheel or mixing chart. You can Google how to mix paint. You'll find a ton of information, guides for artists and stuff like that. You can apply all of that to fabric paint like you would painting on a canvas. Same general color theory.
It's all going to be the pigment theory and not like the light theory. In case any of you guys are white people and two color wheels. So don't look at that one. Look at the pigment.
And if you need to thin your paint out, if you want your paint to be less opaque, you can use something called a color extender to help create that look. So, paint tools, the tools you will need to do all of this painting. We're going to cover some of the brands that you can use. My personal favorite is Jacquard. It's a higher-end artist quality paint, and they make specific textile paints, and they're very opaque, but they're not going to change the hand of your fabric too much. They're going to maintain that softness, so they're a little more expensive, but they are definitely worth the investment, and they have an entire line called the Lumiere line, which is very metallic. So if you need gold or silver or pearly white, awesome. Just, I love them. Tulip and other craft brands are thinner than the high quality paints, and it might take more coats to get the coverage you're looking for. You can also use screen printing ink and use that as paint. It's thinner than paints, but you can often get good coverage, and it's best used with stenciling, which we'll get to a little later. And I think I covered textile medium. That's the stuff you mix in with your paint to make it into fabric paint. So you're going to need some brushes. Because, I guess you could use your fingers, but it might get a little messy. I personally like the synthetic brushes. You want to make sure that it's just something that's not going to shed a lot in your paint, because the last thing you want is a bunch of dried paint bristles in your project when you're done. Or the foam brushes can be good, especially if you need to cover a lot of area.
When you do pick your brush, go with a soft bristle. Hard bristles are going to be leaving those marks in your paint as you're brushing it on, and drying will kind of even those out a little bit, but you'll get a much smoother finish going with a soft bristle brush. And also, your paint is an idiot and it doesn't understand that your brush is not made of fabric. And it will try to permanently bond to your brushes if you don't stay on top of it and wash them immediately.
Yeah, don't ruin your brushes.
Lots. Things to remember with your brushes is just like wigs, you get what you pay for. So if you buy a $4 brush, you're going to get a $4 brush all over your painting project. And they sell over and you make anxiety of it. You never want to wash your brush with hot water, because that is actually going to melt the glue ink that's in the brush holding the bristles in, and it will reduce its life. So whenever you're washing your brush, you want to use cool to room temperature water. I always just get a little dollop of soap and just work it back and forth on that little guy, and then you rinse it out until it runs clear. Maintenance.
You're going to want a paint palette. And you can buy one of those nicer plastic paint palettes. I often use wax paper, freezer paper, because I just have a lot of it around. Newspaper, just something to put your paint on so that you, if you need to do any mixing or you need a lot out, you can do that.
If I'm mixing a color, I'll actually, my custom colors, I'm not going to use more than one, so I'll get the little Tupperwares and I'll mix it in the Tupperware so I can save it, and then I'm done with the project and just clean it out for the next project.
You'll also want some water and some paper towels handy if you need to kind of wash your brush out a little bit while you're sitting doing your project, and you can dry it off. And then lastly, if you want to speed up the drying process a little bit, you can use a hair dryer and just apply a little bit of the low heat, and that'll help speed it up.
Pictures!
Here's some pictures of some of the stuff we just talked about. That's a picture of some textile medium. I've used that brand, it's good. That is a fancy paint palette. I think it's still only like a couple bucks. Some brushes, some foam brushes, some tulip paint, and over there in the right-hand corner is the beautiful jacquard.
Questions, thoughts, feels about paint?
Oh, sorry.
We will answer questions at the end also. Does anyone have any specific,
You may not do this since it's more for like a cloth block, but do you have any tips for faux fabric paint?
Fur, I've done some, it's not really painting because the looks I was trying to achieve were a little different. I have done the Sharpie alcohol method that way back in the day, when we used to not be able to get waves in 30 million colors, we had to dye them with Sharpies. And you can Google that and you'll find an old cosplay.com thread about it. But the general concept is you take 70% rubbing alcohol and you take a bunch of Sharpies and you cut the Sharpies open and you harvest the ink cartridges and then you put them in the alcohol and the alcohol draws the ink out and then you have this ink liquid and you apply that to... It was very messy. I'm very glad we don't have to do this anymore. You spray that on your wig and that was supposed to dye it. I've done that with fur, and it did work for the most part. It bonded pretty decent. It doesn't actually bond. That's a misnomer. It sits on top. The ink sits on top. You're going to want to rinse it out hardcore. It might come off a little. Yes?
Oh, I was just also going to say, if instead of dyeing one solid color, if you want to go and do stripes or things, you can directly Sharpie onto
yes,
it.
Yes, I was going to get to that too.
You can work out a gradient, and then you can actually go in with just a spray bottle of alcohol. You can spray that area, which is going to lift that Sharpie ink again, and you can kind of scumble it together to get a gradient. And also FW Artist Acrylic Inks. They're meant for calligraphy, English, my very first language, and they are fine enough that you can use them to dye fur and also wind fibers, and they are going to be semi-opaque to transparent, all depending on what you see it rated as. I get those at Aesel Art Supply, and dickblake.com has them. And FW is my favorite, but any of those. I know they have some other brand. I'm not sure if they have FW.
I'm very brand loyal. Usually with fur, you dye it. You don't typically paint fur unless you are going for a stripe or something like that. It's usually a lot easier just to dye it.
Yeah. You had a question?
I was just going to add something to that question. If you're dyeing a fur, like a solid fabric, if you know the fiber content of the fur, you can do the synthetic dyes, like the ones that you put on the stove in a big pot, and you can dye it.
We're going to talk about that next, so good lead in.
Sweet, thanks TR. Appreciate you.
It's time.
So, Beauty, I'm going to let you cover the dye.
Right, talk about dyeing. Dyeing basics. So like the lovely cat said, dyeing, you're actually bonding the fiber to your dye, whereas it's not sitting on top, it's living inside the fabric. So every type of fiber is going to have a different type of dye designed for it. So dyeing basics. Most dyes, other than some cold baths, which we'll talk about, will require both intense heat and moisture to do their job correctly. So what this means is that it has to be wet and usually in a large vat.
or a medium style bat. It just depends on how much you're dyeing. The use of a dye bath when dyeing, you do the dye bath to get an even coat. So you could get your fiber wet and then just pour some dye on top of it and like rub it around, and it would dye your fabric and it would dye it poorly. And if that's the look you want, awesome, you've done a great job. But typically when you're dyeing fabric, you're going for a specific look, and usually that's a solid wash. So it's important when you are dyeing to make sure that you have enough water and that your container is big enough for the amount of fabric you're dyeing so it can move around freely and get that even bath. The other thing you want to keep in mind is that dyeing takes time. So you can, there are two things, three things that go into a dye bath that will affect your outcome. The amount of pigment or dye that you put in, the heat of the water, and how much water there is. Doing that right? Yeah, since the heat and the amount of dye. Sorry. Oh, it's been a very long day, forgive me. So you can add more dye to a vat and get a more intense color, or you can turn up the heat to get a more intense color. But usually if you try to get a faster, right? If you try to get a really intense color really fast, it's not gonna be even. So you're better off going with a slower dye vat to get a solid even color at the end. Tangent, sort of. So like I mentioned, there are different types of dye for different types of fiber. So a couple of brands we're gonna go over. Some dyals, which are good for basic colors for most fabrics. The colors are gonna be a little more muted, less saturated. You're not gonna be able to get really vibrant jewel tones, things like that. So those brands are usually gonna be RIT, Dylan, iDye, or the iDye Poly, all those guys that you usually will find at like a Joann's in the dyeing section. And we'll have pictures of most of these too. You're gonna get your acid dyes. Those are designed specifically for protein-based fibers like silk, wool, feathers. You can also use it on nylon. I usually will dye, if I have to dye like those long gloves, I'll make sure they're nylon, and they use acid dye on those. You can get some really vivid, dark, beautiful colors with acid dyes. My favorite brand is Jacquard, the same people that made that sweet paint we were talking about. They also make sweet acid dyes. Or you can get Dharma acid dye, which we'll tell you where to get all this stuff in a minute. Then there are fiber reactive dyes, which are designed specifically for cellulose-based fibers, so like cotton, rayon, linen, bamboo, all that stuff is cellulose. It comes from a plant. Typically, fiber reactive dyes are more complicated than the previous two. Acid dyes and dyals, you throw the dye in there, you heat up the vat, you throw the fabric in there, you stir it around, you pull it out, it's done. The fiber reactive dyes have multiple ingredients that go into them, so they're a little bit more complicated to use. They're not harder, they're just slightly more complicated. Once again, if you want to get those really brilliant colors on a cellulose fiber, this is what you want to go with. The other nice thing about acid or fiber reactive dyes is there's actually a cold bath fiber reactive. So if you don't have a giant dye vat, those cold baths can be really nice for dyeing large quantities. Some of the brands you can go with are like the Dharma fiber reactive dye, Procyon dye. That's the cold bath that I was telling you guys about. One really great thing to remember when dyeing is there is no white. So like with pigment, you can add black or you can add white, and that will make it darker or lighter. The only way you're gonna get your fabric darker or lighter is, you can technically add black to mute the color, but as far as intensity goes, you either want to leave your fabric in longer or add more dye or turn up the heat for your dye bath. And if you want a pastel, you just can't leave it in there very long, pretty much. Questions, thoughts, feels about those things? Cool, because we're gonna move on to the next slide. Boop. Dye saturation. Oh, cool, I'm glad I wrote about this so I didn't have to freehand it confusedly. That's good, go me. Dye saturation. So the more dye you use in a dye bath, the faster it's gonna dye and the quicker it'll adhere to the fabric. And that's not always good, which we covered. I actually think I talked about all of this. Sweet, so let's talk about color testing. You may be wondering, oh, how do I know if my fabric is where I would like my fabric to be? I have just started in a vat of dyeing. It is very hot and I cannot tell. That's why you want to do color testing. So every so often, you want to pull out your fiber, cut off a swatch, rinse it out thoroughly and dry it to see if it's the color you want. Your fabric is always going to look darker when it's wet, obviously. It's always going to look darker when you haven't washed all the pigment out, for obvious reasons. So you're not really going to know where you are until you get it out, rinse it out, and dry it off. And that can take some time, which again is why you don't want to try to quick dye stuff if you're going for a very specific color. Otherwise, by the time you've dried, like rinsed and dried your swatch, the color is already going to have changed because it will already have been in that dye bath that much longer. Let's see. So always color test, or I usually color test. It's a smart thing to do. If there is too much dye in your bath, you aren't going to be able to achieve a lighter shade or any of the ombres you may be going for. So do some testing if you're new to dyeing. Pick an easy project and just try it out to see how you like it and get a feel for it. A lot of dyeing is science. You can recreate the exact same color over and over if you're measuring how much dye you're putting in. But sometimes it can be art too, if you're like me. I'm not as sciencey about it. It's fine, don't worry. You get a feel for it, it's fine. The longer you leave your fiber in there, the fabric in your bath, the more saturated the color is going to become. Which we already talked about. I'm glad I already talked about this. I don't even need this slide. This is great. Next slide. Sweet.
Although of note with that, that also means that if you're dyeing multiple batches, you cannot just use the same batch of fabric dye.
Right. An excellent point. No, keep talking.
Oh, I was just saying, it can be really tempting to be like, oh, this is already the color I want, this is the saturation I want, I've got a second batch, it's the same fabric, it's not going to absorb the same way, don't be tempted by it, just repeat the same ratio.
The thing about dye is that as the, it's not just like an infinite pigment source. As your fabric is soaking up that pigment and it's adhering, it's leaving the bath. Like your bath is being desaturated as your fabric is being saturated. So as you continue to dye and add things to it, you will lose color in your bath, which is exactly why you can't do that, what you just said. Good call, high five. Ooh, aw yes. Dyeing tools. So, things you will want when dyeing. Some of these are also great, like the rubber, like the gloves, like nitrile or latex gloves. Those are great when you're painting too, because who wants paint all over your hands? When you're dyeing, especially with acid dyes, they are meant to dye protein. Guess what we're made out of? It's protein. So they will dye real good. So you want to get gloves, latex or neoprene. Also, if you want to just stick your hands right in that dye vat, you can. But get some of those hardcore high collar rubber gloves, and you'll be good for like 5 minutes at least in boiling hot water. They're pretty great. So I usually use those if I'm taking a large quantity of fabric out of a dye vat that is really hot. You want to get your heat safe container. You use that is what you dye in. You can use your tub, although make sure it's your tub and not your apartment's tub.
Or your parents' tub. If you live with your parents' tub, ask if you can dye a bunch of stuff in their bathtub or washing machine before you do it.
It will technically stain porcelain. It will totally stain porcelain. It'll also stain plastic. It'll basically stain all of it. It won't stain, if they have a stainless steel tub, you're like, go nuts. But otherwise, it's gonna stain the crap out of it. So watch out. You can dye in like giant tubs. Like I have a big tub like this that I'll do cold baths in, or if I need a medium color. Yeah.
Have you ever been to a crawfish boil?
I have a big canning pot too that I use for really hot baths, but I have like a big laundry tub that's like this tall and like this big. And if I'm doing cold baths or like a pastel or something, I can get the water hot enough to dye it in that too. Sinks, washing machines, all that good stuff. Washing machines usually use this stuff like Rit, and you don't really have control over what the color's gonna be at the end.
If you're in a pinch and you're doing a small amount of fabric, you can use a stainless steel kitchen sink. If you've got nothing else, you can go with that, but they're not very big. They're not gonna get a lot. Maybe like a bodysuit, maybe a dress.
Maybe not you, Zane. I'm getting my suit for this
too. You
don't
mind you.
You sound like you're a thing. Glass jars.
What
did you want to say? I sound like you're in a setting. You also want glass jars. You can use whatever, pickle jars, pasta jars, whatever you've got lying around. You don't have to be fancy. You want this to make your dye paste in. So usually when you're dyeing, always when you're dyeing, you don't just throw your dye into your mat, whatever you're dyeing in. That's a really great way to get an uneven dye bath. What a lot of time will happen, especially with yellows, is that all of the pigment won't dissolve into the water, and it'll just be like, oh hey, your fabric, boop. You'll just get a little spot of whatever color it is. And it'll be like, you're not an even piece of fabric, you've got a little boop on you, and I don't love that. So the jars, what you want to do is you want to make a dye paste first, which is where you take your hot water, you put about that much in there, you add your dye to that, you mix it around, and you make sure visibly, because you can see it through the glass, hopefully, that all of the particles of dye have been thoroughly saturated or dissolved.
There we go.
Words!
It's like iced tea versus sweet tea.
Yeah.
Mix in your sugar while it's hot, and you can make a small batch, and then you can cool that down, or you can pour sugar just into that liquid and have it sink to the bottom and sit there
and suffer. Yeah, or it's like iced tea, except instead of adding it to cool liquid, you just add more hot water. Oh, it's sad tea. Disposable mixing sticks. Personally, I like chopsticks, also because I like takeout, usually because I'm in time crunch when I'm doing this, and I'm like, cooking hookups, I'm using all my pots to die in.
don't
eat out of thank you. The responsible one. So usually I'll use like the throwaway chopsticks. I have a couple of tongs that I use. I have a long wooden stick, like a long wooden dowel that I use for big stuff. Use the tongs or the dowel to remove fabric. You're gonna want scissors and a blow dryer or an iron for your for when you're doing your sampling. Pictures! Alright, okay. Yay! So you got yourself a bucket, you got yourself some poly dye, some rit dye, a beautiful mason jar, which again can be your pickle jar. I know you all look like pickle people, don't worry. I'm a pickle person. You got your nitrile, are those nitrile or latex? Personally, I prefer nitrile, they're a little bit thicker. They fit better on me, I don't know. And then there's my favorite thing, jacquard, acid dye. Hooray! Dye tips. Let's talk about tips.
Oh, technology's betraying
us. I'm gonna need to get you a tiny mouse, friend. All right, dye tips. Do not use your dyeing tools to cook food with exclamation marks. See, I was responsible too.
Right there.
Do not dye in porcelain or ceramic. It will stain. Also, plastic will stain. Wash your fabric first. That is really important. Wash your fabric first. Most fabrics will have sightening chemicals or just finishing products on them. And so if you dye, a lot of the times either it will make your dye job spotty or keep the dye from totally adhering or completely adhering, and you'll have wasted all that time and money, and we will be sad. We'll be sad for you. You will post on Tumblr. Your fans will weep. Wash your fabric first. Pre-soak your fabric, once again, to get that even dye job. If your fabric is already wet, if anyone has ever gone out and or you've been in a restaurant and you've got your cup of ice water, you've got your napkin, and slowly your napkin seeps over here and it finds your napkin and it says, oh, napkin, I'm so excited to see you, and it like rushes across your napkin. It's exactly what the water is going to do with your fabric. Now, if you had a wet napkin, I don't know why you'd have a wet napkin, but you have a wet napkin. One that,
That's literally the thing. That's the name
of. You pulled your baby wipe off your face and you put it on the counter. And so when that puddle of water creeps over to your wet napkin, it's going to be like, oh, you're already wet. Whatever. I don't like it. And it's not gonna try to dye all over it. So if you want a really even dye job, you need to pre-soak your fabric. Keep your pre-soaking fabric water handy, because you're gonna need it. Prepare it. That'll be your cold water bath. Like we said, one of the things that causes your dye to adhere and continue to dye is the fact that it's hot. So once you found that color you want, just pulling it out of your bath doesn't mean it stopped dyeing. It's still friggin' hot, so it's still dying. To stop the dyeing process, you need to cool it down, and that's what your cold water bath is for. So I always keep the tub that I have my pre-soaked water in, and that's my cold water bath for the end of my dyeing adventure. Create a dye paste first. We already talked about it, but it is really very important. So do that. Always remove your fabric before adding more dye. So once again, if it's just like when you want to get your fabric wet first, if you just have your you've got your wet napkin on your table. If you just put this isn't a good analogy for this. Sorry, forget about the napkin. So if you've got all of your mostly like semi-dyed fabric in there, if you just dump a bunch of dye or dye paste on top of it, whatever that dye paste hit first, it's gonna start immediately dying. And as it starts dying, it's losing pigment. So once it gets to whatever's below it, it's now less saturated. So you're not gonna get an even dye job if you don't take your fabric out first. Test your fabric before dyeing. I should have started with that, but test your fabric before dyeing, wash your fabric, and then test your fabric. And do your swatch tests, which we talked about, and then dye your fabric before you sew it together. When two pieces of fabric are touching like this, when they're sewn together, they are either A, going to start collecting pigments and dye darker, or B, be like, oh, that's these pigments, I love them, and they'll dye lighter. And you won't get an even dye job. The other thing is that your dye typically is not graded to dye your thread. So what will happen is you'll have blue, like a nice blue dye, and then whatever color thread you used, because it's usually not the same fiber. Yeah. So dye first, sew later. Questions, thoughts, feels? Yes?
What if you're trying to dye a garment, like in a gradient?
And you should just kill yourself. I'm kidding. Please go on. So you're trying to dye a garment that you already have, Lydia?
Yeah.
That's a really great question, and we will talk about it in our next slide. Yeah, you're actually a good lead-in. Any other questions, or can I keep this amazing lead-in? Yes?
When you're washing the fabric first, I'm assuming you don't use fabric softener.
You're so smart. I like you. They actually, there's this special, it's a gentle but very thorough concentrated detergent that I use called Synthrapol. And you can get it where I get all things dye, which we'll have a link for you guys at the end. Dharma Training Co. But yeah, you want to just don't use fabric softener, don't use fancy stuff. Just wash it, yeah. Good call. Questions, other questions? So things to consider. When should I use paint or should I use dye? If you've already got a pre-made garment and you want to ombre dye it, you should paint it. You can dye it, and you can test some of it. Like, I've dyed garments before, but they've always been light colors. What color are you going for?
I was just thinking of the example, but in Dramatic Murder, somebody has a kimono that starts off like red and goes to white.
Yeah. Have you made the kimono already? So dye your fabric first, and then... I have a garment that I dyed the fabric on right and then sewed together. Mm-hmm. So I can show it to you if you want.
And you can go ahead and cut with extra seam allowance. You can cut out your pieces if you're working with a pattern so that you'll know what's hitting where as you're dyeing those pieces of fabric. And you can kind of line them up and get that gradient dye. Rather than dyeing the whole piece of fabric and then hoping your panels are gonna have room to line up the way you're dreaming.
When you're doing a gradient like that, it's exactly like she said. You cut out your fabric piece of pattern first, then cut out your patterns. Usually what I'll do when I'm doing something like that is I'll do my gradient dye. I'll sew part of it together on the top, and then I'll dye the two pieces together so like if it's the back panel or kimono. And then I'll get an airbrush or something like that, and I'll blend it in with an airbrush. If it's too uneven, or you can't get it. But I know not everyone has an airbrush. Go buy an airbrush.
Look at you, all fancy potatoes with my high tech. I've got a compressor in my apartment.
Well,
it's my brother's inside.
Since you're talking about airbrushing, do you have a recommended brand?
Iwata's are really good, mid-grade stuff. The one I like I want to buy a Badger. They make a Badger, it's like $100. But it's top-fed and bottom-fed. So the thing with airbrushes is there's two different types. You can siphon the pigment up from the bottom, or it can gravity feed through the top. And usually the siphoning is a little bit more expensive because it's a little bit more diverse. You can use it on more stuff. But the Badger that I really like and want to test out and look at, it's both. So I'm like, why not? But like, I want to imagine both of them are looking reasonably priced top, so yeah. And they make pretty inexpensive like mini compressors too.
By inexpensive, like, would you have a ballpark?
I think the last time I looked at it was 30 or 50. It was between 30 and 50, as I recall. Yeah, good question. All right, so when should I use painter notes? Someone else talk.
So, as we talked about earlier, paint lives on top, dye lives inside. So the great thing about dye is dye is not going to change the hand of your fabric, and the hand is basically how it feels and how it moves. So if you are doing something that's like super flowy, like an organza cape or something like that, and you don't want it to get stiff, and you don't want a lot of bleed through, and you want it to still maintain some of that transparency, you're gonna want to dye it. But you know, it might not be a solid color. What do you do then? You can paint with dye.
That's a favorite thing.
So things to consider is how much cover it is needed, how big is your piece. If you're making something huge and you need it to be red and you don't have red, you probably want to dye it. You probably don't want to paint like a trench coat or a cape, you know? Yeah. Should the fabric move after it's been painted? So we were talking about the hand of the fabric. Does it need to be flowy? Does it matter if it's stiff?
You're going to interface the crap out of it anyways.
How opaque should the color be? Does it need to be metallic? Does it need to glow in the dark, etc.? You're not going to have a metallic dye. You can't dye something metallic. You're going to have to paint that.
I'm crying too. It's fine. Don't worry.
I don't think you can glow anything, or you can dye anything glow in the dark. No, you're going to have to paint that. Can you commit the resources of time, space, and equipment? Painting with dye is more complicated than painting with paint. And dyeing also takes up a lot of
dyeing with dye is also
more. Takes up a lot of space, a lot of time, a lot of commitment.
And don't be shy to ask your friends if you can use their space or equipment. Like, cosplay has a great community. You probably know other cosplayers.
If you live in Dallas, there's a place in Carrollton called the Maker Space where you. No,
that
but
has,
you.
Like, words to the people.
They do have
a tire area. Do they have a tire area?
I don't think they have anything specifically for dyeing, but they have a lot of space, so you might be able to bring your own.
The deal with Makerspace is that they've got areas designated for different crafts.
Yeah.
Glass work, clay work, metal work, and whatnot. So you can set up an area for dyeing. It's generally open to pay membership.
Right. Pretty cool.
And I think on Thursday nights you can go tour the facility. And if you want access to other awesome tools like a laser cutter or a vinyl cutter, like, it's cool.
And Houston has several maker spaces as well.
A lot of Austin has one too. They're moving shaking those maker spaces.
So here's some examples for straight up fabric painting. So on my left, it's your left? Yes, okay, I'm bad with this. Here, the little tiger symbol on her front, you could easily paint that. You don't have to worry too much about the hand of the fabric, and it's a pretty basic shape. This guy in the middle, the designs on the back of his jacket, the designs along the bottom, that would be super simple to paint. Here on the far right, the pattern on their skirt's not overly complicated, you can mask that off and paint stripes all day long. It's gonna take you some time. Like, it's not gonna be super fast, but you can get the look with paint.
I believe we painted every single one of these, actually. Like I did in a Hannes jacket.
I've done Sonico.
And I will say,
well,
on
that
skirt, if you wanna be a dirty, dirty, horrible cheater, instead of trying to paint it for something like you're going for a custom tartan or you really, really need that fabric to keep the same weft and feel to it, you can go on Spoonflower and custom print fabrics.
I have that pattern actually, so if you want to cosplay from Jitsu or Tajua, you can buy my Spoonflower pattern.
That's a dirty cheater.
That's a different topic, but if you need custom fabric and you need it printed, like a textile,
look it up.
Spoon Flower. I actually also had Sonico's Tiger Camo printed there. So examples for dyeing. It's a PG-13 panel.
I love her shapes.
We have to censor it. So while we're talking about her on the far right, we actually have that dress here in the flesh.
We can shake, guys.
That has an ombre. Here on the left, Tara, there's a whole lot of opportunity for fun here. You can do an ombre, you can paint with some dye on her cape, her leggings. Like, that's a ton of fun. Clamp has a lot of crazy stuff that would be great for dyeing here. Specifically, the outer kimono has that gradient, and her hair accessory has a lot of gradients that will look really nice with some dye. Some techniques for your painting. So you know like how to do it, like how to use the paint, and you've got all your supplies. How do I get the thing I need onto my fabric? You can freehand. You can just dip your brush on in that paint and just go to town.
That's what I do. All about that freehand.
It's exactly like it sounds like. You just paint freehand. Stencil. So all of the designs on the front of this dress, that's all done with a stencil. You can purchase pre-made stencils at the craft store. They're going to be very durable. They're going to last you many, many uses, but you're limited to what is already existing. If you need a custom stencil, like this was all custom, and the method I used for this particular stencil was called the freezer paper stencil method, and I have an entire tutorial that covers this on my blog. If you want cards, I have those later after the panel, that go super into detail on how to do this, but basically, you buy freezer paper, like at the grocery store, and
you have wax paper?
Yeah. Okay. The back has a wax on it, it's very shiny, the front is just paper. And so you can draw your design out on the paper side, you can cut it out with an X-Acto knife or a pair of scissors, depending on how complex it is. And then you iron it wax side down to your fabric, onto your fabric. And since it has wax, your iron, the heat will melt the wax to the fabric, so it sticks. And then you do eye painting, and then you pull your paper up, it doesn't leave any residue. So it's pretty awesome. You always want to test your paper on your fabric before you go and iron like a whole big sheet down. But yeah, that's awesome. It's my favorite method because it's really cheap and it's really easy. The one downside is that it's mostly one-time use. I think I used these side panels. I think I got to use it twice before it went bad. If you're really careful about peeling it up, you can reuse it maybe once, maybe twice if you're lucky. If you have a pattern that you need to be able to reuse a little bit more, but you still need it to be custom, you can use contact paper instead of plastic.
It's like what you put in your drawers when you first move into your apartment. You're like, oh, who was in these drawers before? But then I get the contact paper. And you slap it down there and it sticks. It's basically that. Or you can get the kind that you use in grade school where it's clear. And you can double that up and cut it out. That sometimes, depending on your fabric, will leave a little bit of a stickiness. So do test that one out. But all in all, it did works really well.
Stamping. You can buy pre-made stamps, again, at the craft store. Again, you're limited to what they sell you. And you don't, you probably don't want to use like a rubber stamp for like rubber stamping. You want to look for like the foam stamps for painting walls and stuff like that. Or you can carve your own. You can use craft foam or sponges or vegetables. Always test your stamps on test fabric before you go to town again. Test to make sure it's what you want.
And the stamps aren't really great for super precise lines. They're good if you need something a little bit more organic.
And a couple other tips. You don't want to dunk your stamp in your paint and then go straight to your fabric because you're going to get a big globby mess. Usually you want to brush it on. The foam brushes are really good for that. You just get an even coat of paint on your stamp and then stamp it. small. I'm going to pass this back over to you since this is your forte.
Painting with dye. You can paint many things with dye. It's very much like painting with paint, except not at all. Right, you do use similar tools. There are brushes involved. So you can really paint anything. Typically, you don't want to paint things like velvet or really thick wools. Usually, a thinner fabric is going to be a little bit better because it's going to give the this is the end of the slide. Sometimes, which I want. Sweet. it's going to give the resist that you use too much space to try to get through. So typically what you want to paint, oh, there you go, that's right. You want to paint your fabric if you need a really specific design, but you can't paint it on with regular paint. So on this garment, I didn't want to change the way that the fabric felt, so I painted the whole thing with dye. Typically with painting with dye, what you do is you need to stretch your fabric out. I have this fancy, it's not fancy, I drilled a bunch of holes in a couple of like 1-inch by 2-inch wood planks, and then I got some wing nuts and long screws and I adjust it like that.
Sweet setup.
It's super, really sweet setup. Very expensive and took a long time. It was really, it's pretty fancy. You can also use like PVC pipe. I've seen people just chunk a bunch of PVC pipes together and do it. It works great. You can use, depending on what you're doing, I have fancy silk hooks that I use for mine. They're not actually that expensive, I don't think. But you can do, like I've seen people use the paper binders, like those big black clips. What are those called?
The bulldog clips?
You flip them over and then you have, yeah, those. Yeah, yeah. I've seen people that are there. What? Binder clips, yeah. I've seen people use those and you put them on, and you do the same thing with the silk hooks. You put them on rubber bands and you just rubber band them around and tie them. You just want to make sure your fabric is really nice and taut before you start going at it. And I've got like a mini tutorial. I'm going to use this one. Take your garbage microphone. My mic comes with a bass. You just want to make sure it's really taut so that the fabric your paint doesn't move around, your dye doesn't move around. You'll use a resist. You can use a washout resist, or you can use a paint as your resist, keeping in mind that if you go with a paint, it will slightly change the hand of your fabric. When you put that resist down, remember our napkin analogy? So if on your napkin, when your water is bleeding into your napkin, if you had like a string of spaghetti that bored deep into the napkin and made a barrier, it would cause the water to stop, but your sweet, sweet spaghetti.
It's getting warm.
I think it is. So essentially what a resist is it's going to be a completely waterproof substance that you're going to apply to your fabric before you dye. So that's going to keep that nice and clean and white. When you were a child and you did the bit where you would color with chalk and crayons and then you would draw on it and you would peel it off and the chalk would leave white lines because the wax crayon couldn't come through, it's like that. Well, you didn't go to my public schools, clearly. I'm sorry that Ms. Unkenholz is better than your teacher.
I get those. I get it.
Show of hands, who did that?
Ah, ah, ah.
I like you guys, you're my people. thank you.
A very traditional resist is wax, where you go and you would paint it in wax, and then you have to slowly kind of soak it off or remove it with heat and other things to soak up the wax. An easy and cheap one to do is if you get Elmer's gel glue. Not the normal white glue, but their gel glue. You can actually, that acts as a resist. Just don't let your two layers of fabric touch each other.
Which you never want to do anyways.
And if you guys have questions, it's kind of an involved process, so I'm not going to talk about it forever. If you have questions, you're welcome to ask me about them. I have a couple of tutorials or samples you can look at online. No, I ran out.
You can grab one of my cards and then I'll forward any questions to her. I'll tell you.
You're just a mistake with you. Then you're not a mistake to
you. How
will
her name at the
beginning? Oh, coming. Oh, no, I won't. But I'm going to take questions. Yeah.
well, like with the dye or painting with dye, how do you apply the heat?
Okay, cool. I was right about to start with that. So there are two ways that you can do that. The first way, and it depends on the type of dye you've bought. So you can buy a certain label of dye. It's called it's the red label. And they make a chemical fixative for that. So you can put it in this dye bath, this fixative bath, and it will fix the dye chemically to it. You're not going to be able to get as bright colors with that type of dye. The other method is you wait for it to dry. It's really fun. You wait for it to dry. You take a bunch of newsprint that has no news on it, so blank newsprint. You take multiple layers of that, you take your fabric, you lay it out on your newsprint, you put more newsprint on top, you roll it up into a little sim, you roll it up, then you roll it up again into a little sim, and I swear I have pictures of this, it's much easier to understand in pictures. You tape it shut, and then you stick it in essentially a steam bath. So I got my steam bath out of a canning pot, a vegetable steamer, a can of beans with the label and both ends taken off. It's clean. I ate the beans. I cleaned the can, lady. It was a regular sized can. I could have eaten that many beans. Okay, you put it past me. You basically set your little cinnamon roll on there. You want to make sure no water is touching it, so I put a couple more layers of paper over it. I put a big towel on top of that, I put the lid on, I put a 5-pound weight on the lid, and you steam it for like 2 hours. And then, after 2 hours are done, making sure you haven't burned it, because I've done that before. So bad. Little bad. Okay, I'm making sure it's all good. You take it out, you rinse it all out, and then it's fixed. So that's where your heat comes from. That's where your moisture and your heat comes from. Okay. It's more complicated than dyeing because none of the fabric can touch itself and you can't get any water on the fabric while it's fixing or it'll bleed. And then you're boned. What's up?
And so you said newsprint with no newsprint? So
yeah.
It's like the paper.
It's just the newsprint.
If you use the actual newspaper,
it'll get out of there, yeah. You can also just use like muslin. Okay. It doesn't have to be paper, but the paper's cheaper than just buying a butt ton of muslin. So we've talked about a lot of really great products. The place I buy my dyes, my newsprint, all of this junk, the paints, is Dharma Trading Company. And they're basically the bomb.com. I mean, they're a website, so I can say that without feeling too funny and bad and terrible. They're amazing, and the staff are really amazing too. I have questions all the time, and they're like, oh yeah, you can use this, lady. Oh, thank you, Jewel. You're the best. What's up? Dharma. D-H-A-R-M-A. Dharma Trading Company. They're super cool, super great. So we have about 10 minutes left.
Now we have about 6 minutes.
We have about 6 minutes left, but I'm sure we can bleed over a little bit. Does anyone have any questions? We have some samples up here.
If you guys
want to
look at any of them. So we've got a couple of samples of fiber-reactive dye. So that dress, this was all done fiber reactive. It's actually 2 dye jobs. So I dyed the blue first, and then I dyed the dark blue on top of it. And because it was a cold bath, I had to dye a lot of it, and I had to dye it in pieces. Because it was a cold bath, I was able to dye it after I had sewn it together, because I could really work the dark dye into the seams to make sure it stuck. And because it was cold, I could use my hands to do that. So that's the fiber.
With gloves. With gloves. Don't forget the gloves.
Unless you want blue hands.
Which, right. You live your life. Do your best to do. So that's the cold. That's the fiber reactive. This is this is acid dye, and this is just grit. So this one used to be white. So this is grit, and this is acid. So some things you can do with that. This was white. It's cream now. I dyed that in my tub. It's fine. Tub is fine, everyone. It's fine. This is an example of fabric painting. So this is that whole weird process I just talked about. For this one, I had to do my patterning first, stencil everything out, dye each piece individually, and then match it up when I sew it together. This is shoe work, so this is all ways to treat leather. If you guys had questions about that, you can use acid dyes to dye feathers. This is an example of stenciling, so we cut out a bunch of little stencil stripes.
That's all freezer paper.
It's all freezer paper stuff. Freezer pencil, the freezer paper method.